So I'm hopefully I'll be up to speed with today. So we can see your screen. Okay, that's good. So as Richard is unmuting everybody, please remember to mute yourselves. I will be sending out this part two handout. With my crazy schedule, I forgot to do it, so I'll send it out hopefully tonight or over the weekend. And so I'll get that out as quickly as I can for folks. So without any further comment, Dr. Kuhn, it's all yours.
All right. Do I have to drop to the bottom, this little panel that I'm seeing?
Okay. Nope. We can't see it. We just see your screen without any of the little window. That's the.
Okay. Well, I don't want that little window because there. Well, now I want to point to the other side. How do I get rid of it?
You press.
Just hit the orange arrow.
Got the orange arrow. Got it. Okay.
There we go.
All right. So welcome back to part two. So let's sort of continue. We're talking about environment. Isn't this a gorgeous view of environment?
Oh, yeah. Wow.
All right. Start out with a little humor. What do you think about a New Mexico dry cleaner that advertises 38 years in the same spot? Did you take your clothes to them? Okay. And how about Bill? He's in Brooklyn. He says, we do not tear your clothing with machinery. We do it carefully by hand. Apparently, Bill's had a few complaints. And this cleaner up in Maine says, drop your pants here and you'll receive prompt attention. I bet you will. And have you seen this guy?
I have seen that one before.
Isn't that amazing? And I love the name of the plumber, AIM. Wow. Good one. All right, so here are objectives. The objectives are the same as they were for our first presentation. Let's just review what we did last month. We looked about where toxins come from. We looked at water, air, food, and home safety. Well, this month we'll continue and we'll look at products we put on our body, because we certainly do put a lot of them on there. The drugs we take, cell phones, microwaves, and then what can we do as a single individual to reduce some of the environmental impact about toxins? So if we can, we'll talk a little bit about maybe what we can do, the fix. All right, so again, everything I'm saying is evidence-based. So let's begin with products we put on our body. And what I'd like to do is to show you a little video. It's about 8 minutes long, but it will sort of introduce what I am going to talk about.
This is a story about a world obsessed with stuff. It's a story about a system in crisis. We're trashing the planet, we're trashing each other, and we're not even having fun. The good thing is that when we start to understand the system, we start to see lots of places to step in and turn these problems into solutions. Can I tell you, I love my Pantene Pro-V. Of the dozen or so personal care products that I use every day, it's the one I can't live without. It says it gives my dull hair the ultimate cool shine. How does it do that? I was wondering that while I was lathering it in my hair one day, so I read the ingredients right here. Sodium lauryl sulfate, tetrasodium EDTA, methyl isothiazolinone. What is this stuff? I took this list to some scientists who know how to read it. Turns out my Pantene contains a chemical linked to cancer. And lots of other products in my bathroom, from sunscreen to lipstick and even baby shampoo, also contain chemicals linked to cancer or other problems like learning disabilities, asthma, and even damaged sperm. Like most parents, I try to keep my family safe. But now I find out my bathroom is a minefield of toxins? What are we supposed to do? To find out the answers, we have to go back to one of the key features of our materials economy, toxics in, toxics out. If, at the factory, you pour toxic chemicals into a product, like baby shampoo, you're going to wind up with toxic baby shampoo and toxics in workers, communities, and, babies. So let's take a closer look at this toxic outrage where it seeps into our lives every day, in the bathroom. The average woman in the U.S. uses about 12 personal care products daily. The average man, about 6. Each product containing a dozen or more chemicals. Less than 20% of chemicals in cosmetics have been assessed for safety by the industry safety panel, so we just don't know what they do to us when we use them. Would you fly on an airline that only inspects 20% of its planes? Of course, not all of these chemicals are dangerous, but we know that many are. Some are carcinogens. That means that they can cause cancer. Others are neurotoxins and reproductive toxins, proven to mess up brain development and reproduction in animals. Wait a minute. We're animals, too. It's like a giant experiment. We're using all these mystery chemicals and just waiting to see what happens. One thing we do know is that they're getting inside us. I had my body's toxicity levels tested, and I'm loaded with things like mercury, flame retardants, triclosan, and lead. We all are. Even babies are being born pre-polluted. Now, I know we can't live in a lead-free world, but do we have to put lead in our lipstick? I don't know. Maybe it's my fault. Maybe I just bought the wrong thing. At the store, the choices seem endless. I can get lipstick in 49 shades, or shampoo for hair that's too dry, oily, fine, and limp, or frizzy. But what about the choices that really matter, like the choice to buy products that are safe? It turns out the important decisions don't happen when I choose to take a product off the shelf. They happen when companies and governments decide what products should go on the shelves. So who are these companies? This is Procter & Gamble. They're the ones offering me Herbal Essences, the number two shampoo in the country. It contains toxic petrochemicals made from oil. Since when is oil an herb? On cosmetics labels, words like herbal, natural, even organic have no legal definition. That means that anybody can put anything in a bottle and call it natural, and they do. I mean, can you imagine a top seller called Petro Essences? Gross. What's even nastier are hair relaxers marketed to five-year-olds and skin whitening creams. These are super toxic, both in their ingredients and in the message they send about what beauty is. Oh, here's Estee Lauder offering me a chance to help find a cure for breast cancer. That's nice. But wait, they're also using chemicals linked to cancer. Don't you think the best way for Estee Lauder to fight cancer is to stop using those chemicals in the first place? So really, I get to choose between meaningless claims on a bottle. But these guys get the real choice about what goes into those bottles. And that happens back here, at the factories where they're formulated. Why do the makers of these products use all these toxics? Are they trying to poison us? No, they're just working from a 1950s mindset where people were totally swept up in better living through chemistry. In all that excitement, they forgot to worry about human health impacts. That was years ago, and they are still using these same old toxic chemicals. Today, big cosmetics companies say the doses of poison in the products are small enough to be harmless. Yeah, maybe if you use them once a year. I guess they never get up and see that their products are being used and combined with other products every day. A little toxic dose under your arms, a little more on your hair, on your lips. And workers in nail and hair salons get dosed all day long. So the industry is used to doing things this way, and they can, because even now that scientists have linked the chemicals they're using to all sorts of problems, there are no laws to get rid of them. You're thinking, really? Come on, nobody's making sure that the stuff we smear all over our bodies is safe? Nope. The FDA doesn't even assess the safety of personal care products or their ingredients. Since 1938, they've banned just 8 out of over 12,000 ingredients used in cosmetics. They don't even require that all of the ingredients be listed on the label. Now, this is an example where we can all agree a little more government action would be helpful. This lack of regulation leaves a huge hole that the cosmetics industry is all too happy to fill. They set up their own committee to self-police their products, and compliance with their recommendations is voluntary. So the cosmetics industry is making the rules and then deciding whether or not to follow them. So you see, it isn't our fault that these toxic products are in our bathrooms. It's a whole broken system that's ignoring the simple rule, toxics in, toxics out. But we're not helpless. There are resources online that we can use to protect ourselves by identifying the best possible choices in the store. But the real action is with people working to change the system. Because if we really want to solve this problem, we got to start here, with these guys. Women, parents, workers, people all over the country are demanding that Congress pass a new law, giving FDA the power to make sure that our personal care products are safe. We need common sense laws based on the precautionary principle. That means that when you're dealing with hazardous chemicals, just err on the side of caution. Let's not debate how much lead should be allowed in lipstick. Just get the toxic chemicals out of our products. Smarter laws would force companies to get past that old 50s mindset and figure out how to get us all clean and shiny without toxic chemicals. Can they? Totally. Many responsible cosmetics companies are already putting safer products on the market. Green chemists are developing substances that are designed to be safe and non-toxic in the first place. European governments have required the removal of many toxic chemicals, and companies have figured out how to comply. When cosmetics are reformulated to be safe and labeled honestly, then we can feel comfortable with the choices available at the store. We can choose bouncy hair or full hair, shiny lipstick or matte. We can even choose to feel beautiful without using 20 products. But we'll know that whatever we choose, the most important choice, the choice to be safe and healthy, has already been made.
All right, isn't that an eye-opener? It's amazing what we put on our bodies.
So the name of that is called The Products We Use on Our Bodies?
I don't remember. But that's the YouTube address. Okay, so I've given you the address on the slide.
Okay, great. Perfect.
Because I really think that needs to be shown to other family members, too. Okay.
You know, it's funny, it just quickly, just so you know, I was talking with some patients this morning in our waiting room, and there was a bunch of people there, and no one knew about the parabens or any of this stuff.
That is scary.
It is scary, yeah. Go ahead, sorry.
Oh, that's okay. Okay, so toxins in our cosmetics, where do they come from? Well, you already saw that in the little video, and why are they there? Well, they're there to act as broad-spectrum protection from molds and yeast and bacteria. Nail polish, if you put nail polish on, ladies, how long do you want it to last? An hour or a week? They make it chip resistant, and scents will last longer. Okay, this is the most toxic nail polish in the world. When OPI wanted to go international and sell their products in the European Union said, absolutely not, it's toxic. So what they did was to reformulate it so it could be sold in the European Union. All right, question. What do you think they sell back in the United States? The same old stuff, because we've never demanded that they make it safer for us. All right, so we're talking about all of these things. These things become endodisruptors. They are hormone interrupters. They act like make-believe hormones in the body. They mimic estrogen. Now, where are they found? There's 17,000 registered pesticides to the EPA. 17,000. So just a little comment. You want to be very careful to not buy from countries. This is sort of off the point a little bit, but buying food from countries that do not use our registration for pesticides. Chile is one of them. Chile uses unregulated pesticides. And where do we get a lot of our produce from during the winter? Chile. So be careful, okay? These endodisruptors are found in all kinds of cleaning supplies and beauty products, shower curtains. Artificial leathers. You buy a new car, you got that wow, wonderful new car smell. Where does it come from? All of the endodisruptors that are leaving the plastics from the car interior and engine that are now inside the car. Well, you're inside the car too. And just one comment, if you've bought a new car recently, what do you have to do to a new car the first 6 or 7 months that you don't have to do as often after it gets older? Anybody? Well, what you got to do is wash the windows. Don't they get sort of, oily? They have this slick on them? Those are the plasticizers, okay? And remember, you're breathing that in. They're in our hospitals as well. So you go in the hospital, you got an IV bag with these plasticizers in them. I'm not going to go here, but here is a list of the top 10 endodisruptors, and there's the address. You can just go there and look. Call the Dirty Dozen for endodisruptors, and we'll talk about a few of those. Okay, so endodisruptors are very powerful, mimic our estrogens, and they become xenoestrogens. Xenoestrogens act even more strangely in the body, and they can lead to a lot of things. We have now associated them with an increase in metabolic syndrome, metabolic X, and obesity. do we have an issue with metabolic X and obesity in the United States? Hey, you bet. Well, is there research to support the problem? Remember, and they still do, I guess, miners. What do they take down in the shaft with them? Canaries. Because if the canary breathes in gases that are toxic, the canary drops dead, and that says to the guys, hey, we got to get out of here. Well, we actually have our own canary. It's amphibians, frogs. Frogs have actually been declining for years because, remember, they live in groundwater that has the toxins, that has all the chemicals in it that we are eliminating. And pesticides, one particular nasty pesticide, turns frogs into both sexes, male and female. Well, they're not going to be able to procreate too bad, too much, too well like that. We're also getting frogs with three legs, okay? Now, this particular pesticide, azoxystrobin, was actually banned in the European Union way back in the early 2000s. It came up for a vote in the summer of 07 in our U.S. Congress. It's made by Syngenta. And they spent a lot of money lobbying, and guess what? Congress gave them unrestricted use forever. So all I can say is, look, good luck, Kermit, because you're going to need it. So Kermit is our canary, and we'd better watch, because things are happening to him and things are happening to us as well. Also, here's an interesting point. What can this do to humans? Well, there was a factory, a petrochemical plant that was built on the St. Lawrence. And prior to 1993, before it was built, there was a normal boy-girl relationship for women giving birth. After the plant, and continuing today, because the city is now downstream of the petrochemical plant, we're having 35% fewer boy births because of these estrogen-like products that are now in our environment, that we're slathering on our bodies and we're taking in multiple forms. That's sort of intriguing. All right, the Breast Cancer Foundation is now lobbying Congress to ban parabens because they find when they do their research, 18 of every 22 breast cancers has intact parabens in the tumor. Now, when pathology does a pathology report on the breast cancer, they don't look at that. But if they looked, they'd find it. Is that scary? Oh, wow. And this is the first time in history that our children will not be as healthy or long-lived as their parents. So where do we find these endodisruptors and xenoestrogens? Well, we're going to talk about phthalates, parabens, and bisphenol. Phthalates. Well, when you look at the label, you sort of saw that a little bit in the video. When you saw that, when you look for phthalates on the label, you're going to look for parabens. And I don't care what they are, methyl, propyl, butyl, ethyl, I don't care. If it's a paraben, it's a paraben. Propylene glycol and then other names that you'll never be able to pronounce. So these are phthalates. Now, again, some great websites to go to if you're interested in following more information on phthalates. And in the video, and I think it was the story of cosmetics, she talks about safecosmetics.org. That is a site where you can go and look at safe cosmetics. They're companies that you probably don't recognize. You're going to have to get them online, or you're going to have to get them in the health food store. The ones that you can buy in your department store are the ones that are the most toxic. All right, let's move to bisphenol A. I got a little couple of minute video to show you here, just as an introduction.
Scientists have known for decades, since the 1930s at least, and alternative news sources like Infowars.com have long documented that the compound bisphenol A, BPA, disrupts the hormonal system, causes infertility and even cancer. But governments didn't warn about the dangers of BPA, widely used in plastic bottles, food cans, and soda cans, until only a few years ago. For more on why, I filed this report for InfoWars Nightly News.
Bisphenol A. When you open up a can, that lining may contain a synthetic estrogen. That's right, a sex hormone.
BPA is unsafe and can lead to cancer, diabetes, and other diseases.
BPA is what is known as an endocrine disruptor.
Canada became the first country in 2010 to ban the use of BPA in just some products. and Europe soon adopted many of these bans. However, in the U.S., the Food and Drug Administration has been much more reluctant to admit the dangers.
The Food and Drug Administration is not ready to sound the alarm.
The Food and Drug Administration says the chemical known as BPA is not dangerous. This despite the fact that a 2004 CDC study found BPA in the urine of well over 90% of the U.S. population.
Okay, bisphenol A is everywhere. Let's see if I can get my slides back up again. So bisphenol A is also a endodisruptor. It's also a xenoestrogen. And remember what they said in the video, almost all Americans carry a measurable level of BPA in the range that it can cause cellular changes. Now remember where we said it was, it lines cans. So have you ever eaten out of a can? Makes sense that we've got a measurable level. It lines soda cans, beer cans, drink out of a bottle whenever you can. Bisphenol A used to be in baby bottles, but fortunately about 3 years ago, the federal government did ban bisphenol A in baby bottles. So now it is no longer affecting our babies. But certainly they're getting it from many places. So we know, based on research, the highest level of BPA at the time that you are pregnant equals the highest miscarriage rate, which can be as high as 80%. The highest bisphenol A urine level during pregnancy, the more likely your child is going to have anxiety, allergies, learning problems at age 3. Wow. And remember, this stuff hangs around in our body forever. Once it's in there forever. You can't get rid of it. The idea is, don't put it in to begin with. The highest levels in people as we get older, the more coronary artery disease and the more type 2 diabetes. And gentlemen, the higher levels, the lower your sperm count. And we know today that we are more infertile in the United States than we've ever been in the history of the United States. Could be associated with these estrogen disruptors and xenoestrogens that we have in our system. All right, let's sort of switch gears, but we're still staying with stuff we put on our body. How about nanoparticles? Nanoparticles, as you can see in the slide, are teeny tiny little particles. And what they do is they change the structure and form of a product, and they actually allow this product to be absorbed into the body quicker and easier because it's being carried on these teeny tiny little microscopic products. Therefore, it can go through the skin, carried in the vascular system, in the lymphatics, can go to the lung, it can cross the blood-brain barrier, it can penetrate every defense in our body. Now, where are these found? Anti-aging cosmetics, deodorants that last 24 hours, wrinkle-free, stain-free clothing. Well, not a big deal for us, but zinc oxide. Have you ever used zinc oxide that's clear? It's got nanoparticles in it. It's a huge industry, and it's not going to go away. The cosmetic industry is one of the big time users of nanoparticles because they say this is the easiest way to give this product into our skin. L'Oreal ranks 6th in patents for nanoparticles. Dior patents liposomes. So you want to be careful about these products. These are nanoparticle products, so you don't want them on your shelf. How about Arbonne? They describe themselves as all natural, all organic, and you already know that those terms are not definable. They're not backed up by anything. They are a nano company. They use nanoparticles in their cosmetics. What's even scarier is you don't need FDA approval to make a product with a nano cosmetics. There's over 200 companies right now that are using nanotechnology. You can see that website, the Nanotech Project. You can go there and you can find out the companies that use nanoparticles and the ones that don't. And obviously those are the ones that you want to use. Here's some cosmetic companies choosing not to use nanotechnology. You may have heard of some of those. You may not have. Okay, and there's a whole lot more on that website. Kiss My Face. Kiss My Face advertises itself as organic, natural, no nanoparticles, but there's parabens in it. So you gotta read the label very carefully, regardless of what the company tells you on the bottle. good companies are on safecosmetic.org. I've talked about that. So go there, find Safe Cosmetics. They do an expose on suntan lotion every spring. And you'll find that out of the 600 or 700 suntan lotions on the market, there's only 5 or 6 that are actually listed as safe and that work. So safecosmetics.org is a wonderful, should be a favorite on your computer. Bad products, where do you find them? Go to this website. Also, it also lists chemicals that you want to be wary of. Not only the parabens, but there's many other chemicals in products that are unsafe. So it gives you the list and it gives you what they cause. Well, the American Chemical Society has an opposing view with just about everything I'm saying. Remember, they work hand in hand with the cosmetic and the fragrant companies, also the pharmaceutical industry. So they're on big business side. They say there is absolutely no problem. They looked at urine levels in women who use these paraben-rich cosmetics, and they find no problem. Well, interesting is that they also communicate with the Breast Cancer Association, and they say, again, there's no connection with breast cancer because there's no increase in estrogens. Well, there's several thousand studies that point to there is a problem. Can all of those studies be wrong and the American Chemical Society is right? You got to think who they're working for, okay? Let's...
Dr. Kuhn?
Yes.
Rob Longo, just to let you know, there's a recent thing that came out in WebMD, and I'll try to remember to send it to you, and I think it's going to go out in this listserv as well, or I've already sent it out. WebMD showed a study that was recently done that 99% of women with breast cancer had evidence of parabens.
Is that scary?
That's what I say, people, 99%, that's pretty damn pure science. You can't beat
absolutely.
That number.
Absolutely. I mean, how can you argue with that? And the American Chemical Society would argue with that, okay? And I didn't put the slide in there, but the American Chemical Society, when they do their rat research, there's all kinds of rats out there. You can, you know, genetically modify a rat, and they use rats that are insensitive to estrogen. Intriguing, huh? Okay, so estrogen-like compounds are environmental pollutants, so where do you find them? All those words that I've used before. Okay, so think about estrogen in excess that is coming into our body. Now, it not only is a carcinogen and it causes other issues, but we're also finding that it affects thyroid function. Estrogen in excess inhibits the conversion of T4, which we primarily make in our thyroid, to active T3. Okay, so it blocks the conversion and the production of T4. So we have difficulty with thyroid function, okay? And we are now seeing more thyroid disorders than ever before in the United States. Certainly could be associated with what we're slathering on our body and what we are eating. So maybe the fix, try to eat organic. Be careful what products you put on your body, and have that safecosmetics.org as one of your favorites. Check it out before you go buy products. Okay, some final thoughts on these kinds of issues. High dose exposure we know is toxic, but low dose, little tiny bits in 20 products a day over a lifetime, what's the exposure? And you just told me 99% of women have high levels of parabens who have breast cancer. Obviously, that is the lifetime exposure. All of these products have been around for 50 years, but there's really no long-term research that proves their safety. The Nurses' Health Study has been looking at this for multiple years, and they've demonstrated again that these products are not safe. National Institute of Child Health, way back, was going to do a study of children from birth to 21 years looking at environmental chemicals. They were going to do fat analysis and then compare it to what they were eating. Sounds like a great study. Way back when, President Bush eliminated the funding, and no other president has ever suggested that this be refunded. Now, think about the diseases, metabolic X, diabetes, heart disease. This costs us billions of dollars annually if we could only get rid of this stuff or limit its use in our bodies. So never buy cosmetic products claiming to have antioxidants or fancy ingredients, plant extracts, okay, that come in a jar what are you going to do? You're going to stick your finger in, which has bugs and fungus and molds on it. And what are you going to do? You're going to contaminate that jar by tubes or pumps. So don't buy cosmetics that you got to dig out with your finger. Always check the box at the cosmetic counter because the ingredients are rarely listed on the product themselves. They're listed on the box. So look before you buy. Look for water availability as opposed to fat availability. And if it lists pH, you want a pH below 5 because bacteria has difficulty growing in an acid medium. Look for botanicals that have lavender, calendula, rosemary, citrus. They not only are antibacterial, but they also help nourish and heal the skin. Liquid crystal technology is a new technology, and it's safe because it's too big. It can't enter the skin like the nanoparticles do. Sensitive or irritated skin, hey, drop the dryer sheets. What do you think they're made out of? Perfume and nanoparticles, parabens, phthalates. Yeah, you might have soft, smelly clothes, but there's certainly some consequences. For skin protection, use night creams. That's when the body heals and repairs itself. Just make sure they're safe. And always think about sunscreens, at least SPF 15, but again, look at that website, safecosmetics.org, in the springtime for the expose on suntan lotions, and you'll be able to buy safe suntan lotion. Don't forget your vitamin D. Okay, if you live above Atlanta, at least 5,000 international units a day. If you live below Atlanta, 2,000 to 3,000 is safe. And don't rely on marketing messages like celebrity endorsements. They're making money on the product. Do your homework first. Sort of feels like we're in this big sinkhole, doesn't it? All right, let's move on. A couple of new things in here. Where do you spend the most time each day? Think about it. Where do you spend the most time each day? If you came up with on your mattress where we sleep, you could be right. All right? Well, what's in mattresses? You're not going to believe this. Formaldehyde, triclosan, antibacterial bedding. You're going to inhale it. Flame retardants, heavy metals, pesticides, fluorochemicals. Wow, that's what we sleep on. It eliminates gases. You breathe them in. They touch your skin through the sheets every single day. So look for organic mattresses next time you buy. Yes, they are more expensive, but look at what you are breathing in if you sleep on a regular traditional mattress. It's scary. All right, how about drugs we take? Well, many of the IV bags, the IV tubings, are made out of polyvinyl chloride, PVC. PVC, we talked about last time, that's the number 3 plastic. You don't want to eat out of it. You don't want to store food in it. I wouldn't think we'd want to put IV fluids in it, run it through the PVC tubing, and give it to patients. But we still have a lot of PVC products around. When you put an acid drug into this PVC IV bag, it leaches more and more and more of the plastic, and then what do? We give it directly IV to you. Wow, talk about a way of increasing your nasty plasticides. Well, do we make PVC-free bags and tubings? Yes. Braun has been in the business of doing this for over 30 years. A couple of other companies, Hospira and Baxter, in 2006, there was a big push to make all IV products PVC-free. And in 2006, both of them said, we're doing research. We'll replace our products. They still have not replaced their products, and they are still making most of their products PVC. There are lots of sites, if you want to get on the bandwagon, that will talk about ways to improve our IV health, if you will, in the hospital. And the FDA really has a warning about this stuff in IV bags. If you want to look at the report, it was actually published in 2002. It's been updated several times since. It's hundreds and hundreds of pages long. So the federal government knows how dangerous this PVC or DEPH is in the IV bags, but all they do is post a warning. Because remember, we're dealing with big business. Hospital patients and hospital staff are at risk. If you're receiving a blood transfusion, if you're on mechanical ventilation, hemodialysis, think about all those tubes. All of them are made out of plastic. And you can find a high level of these plasticizers in the urine of somebody who just had hemodialysis or just had a blood transfusion. Well, some other things that are really environmentally not safe in hospitals and other buildings, how about floor stripping and waxing? Think about all that stuff in the environment. So new floors don't require wax. Those are the best kind of floors to put in. And we really have a new disease that a lot of healthcare professionals that work in hospitals are developing. It's called hospital-acquired asthma. Think about the floor chemicals, the disinfectants, all of those things that they breathe in. And, for instance, we know statistically that nurses have a much higher level of asthma than people who do not work in healthcare. Other things to be concerned about in healthcare, how about mercury? And there are some safe hospital systems out there. So there's no reason why you can't have a safe hospital that has done away with a lot of the things that cause damage in patients and in staff. How about cell phones? Do you have a cell phone?
Dr. Kuhn?
Yes.
Yeah, hi. What about the CPAP machines? Anything on that as far as the masks?
You've got to check to what plastic they're made out of. Many of them are still made out of PVC. And while I mentioned PVC, what are all the pipes in your house? Unless you had a lot of money when you built your house and put all your hot water and cold water in copper, all the pipes of water in our house are PVC. Now, of course, the PVC manufacturers say, there's no leaching. But when you continually run hot water through those PVC pipes, guess what? After years, those PVC pipes begin to leach. We're doomed. It's scary. Somehow or other, I guess I was smart enough. I renovated an old house in the 80s, and this was just becoming known, and I actually had our plumber put in copper hot and cold water. He hated me because it was so much extra work, but I've got copper. Okay, a little extra copper in my body isn't going to hurt. PVC might. So the CPAP, you got to look at the plastic. Some are made with non-PVC, but some of them are made with PVC. And you don't want to be breathing all of that moist air if it goes through PVC. Okay? All right, cell phones. Cell phones emit radio frequency energy, radio waves. The more you spend on the phone, the more radio waves you're exposed to. If you've ever looked, when you got a new phone, if you ever looked real carefully on the literature that came with your print, we're going to call it mice print. Only mice can read it. There is a warning on your phone that says keep 5/8 to 1 inch from your ear to avoid unnecessary contamination. Does anybody know that that's there as a warning? Probably not. You never read that stuff. Russia actually prohibits the use of cell phones in anyone less than 18 years of age. Hey, maybe they're onto something. Well, cell phones alter brain waves. We know what those radio waves do. And we know that people who are having sleep issues, we want to tell them not to talk on their cell phone for at least 2 or 3 hours prior to sleep, because you want those brain waves to sort of settle down and not be so excitable by the radioactivity from the phone. Cell phones cause brain cancer. This book, Dr. Davis works for NIH, and it took her about 11 years to write the book, Disconnect. And she absolutely, positively has connected the use of cell phones to brain cancer, particularly in kids. And brain cancer and brain tumors are on the uprise. I wonder why. Who classifies cell phones as possibly carcinogenic way back in May of 11? Interesting. And the more data streams that your phone carries, the higher the danger because there's more radioactivity. And speaking of kids, if Russia says no child can work, talk on a cell phone prior to 18, maybe that would be a good thing for us. And I know many kids that have cell phones when they're 6 and 7 years old. Why do they need a cell phone? They don't. So we need to be careful of those kids coming up. Fortunately, I think most of our teenagers today with phones text, so it's not an issue, holding it close to their head. But if you've got teenagers that talk a lot, then certainly we need to limit talk time. Are microwaves safe? Well, microwaves are, again, high-frequency radio waves. We also use them in telecommunication and mobile phones. But we've used radio waves or microwaves for a long time. They're pro. The federal government says they're safe. Industry says they're safe. Have we ever done large-scale studies to prove they're safe? No. The con. Microwaves remove everything from water. This was a very small study. They studied 8 people, and they gave them only microwaved food for 7 days. At the end of the 7 days, they had a low hemoglobin, they had a very low good cholesterol, HDL, and they had very low white cells. They had a much higher cholesterol and bad cholesterol, LDL, than when they started. So do microwaves change the food that we're eating? Yes. We know that breast milk that's warmed at high temperature loses 96% of the immune globulin A. That's what babies need for immunity. So moms need to be careful about warming their breast milk in a microwave. Okay? The con breaks down B12 into inactive substances. No wonder we see so many B12 deficiencies, particularly in older folks who are more likely to use a microwave more frequently because it's easier to heat up things than it is to make things from scratch. It releases potentially toxic compounds from food packaging. So therefore, you never want a microwave in plastic. Okay? And we know that vegetables lose antioxidants and nutrient value. Con, they make a lot of radiolytic compounds. So do you want to be anywhere near a microwave while it's in operation? No way. You want to stand at least 3 feet away from your microwave. Tuck it around in the corner so it's protected by your refrigerator so you don't stand directly in front of it. The big thing with modern kitchens is to put your stove sort of in the middle of the wall and your microwave over the top of it. Well, anybody within 3 feet of that stove and microwave is going to have a little extra microwave activity. So again, don't put plastic in your microwave. Well, microwave, what do you put in there? Never threes, never PVCs because they're going to leach plastic. The yellow polyethylenes, the ones, the fours, the fives, and you don't do it if you don't have to. And what you want to microwave in always is glass. Cover it with a piece of paper towel. Glass doesn't give anything to food, it doesn't take away anything from food, and it is safe.
Dr. Kuhn?
Yes.
I don't know if you're aware, there was a story some years ago about a nurse who decided that they were warming up the blood. I guess it had been in a cool place before they gave the transfusion. And so she put it in the microwave and immediately killed the person.
Oh, my God.
I think that should make it clear that microwaves change the content of any biological active ingredient.
You know, I've never heard that, but I do know that, you know, I teach nursing, and we tell people never microwave blood. And that's probably why.
Yep.
If it changes blood in a plastic bag, what's it doing in our bodies? Obviously, it's making some change. So be careful. Okay.
Zip on the nutrition, as far as I can see,
yeah,
basically just acts as filler. So there's no real nutrition available.
Right. Absolutely. Okay. So let's talk about reducing the impact of environmental toxins. Is there a fix? I'm going to look at a little bit statistics. I'm going to talk about inflammatory foods and then anti-inflammatory foods that are going to hopefully be our fix. Harvard School of Public Health, way back a couple years ago, said that right food choices, exercise, and not smoking, look at what it can do to decrease disease. We are the country with the highest level of chronic disease in the world. Is that scary? All right, so inflammatory food, what is it? Meat, trans fat, fried food. What's a serving? Cooked steak or a burger, 3 ounces. Sausage, ham, or processed meat, 1 ounce. And bacon, a half an ounce. The idea is no more than 3 ounces or less 1 to 2 times a week. I mean, how many people go to the big steakhouse on Saturday night and have a 16-ounce prime rib? Wow, you're a little over for this week and probably the next 2 or 3 weeks as well. The effects on our planet, on our environment, 7 pounds of grain to produce 1 pound of beef, and it takes 800 to 1,000 gallons of water to produce 1 pound or 1 grain to produce 1 pound of beef. Think about the majority of the farmland in the United States today is used to grow animal feed. Substituting chicken, fish, or eggs really saves our environment. It's like not driving 760 miles a year. Going vegetarian only one day a week, if we all did that, it's like not driving 1,100 miles, which would save in gas. And our environment, our air, we talked about last week, how about greenhouse gases that are destroying our atmosphere? Look at where they come from. 46% come from growing beef or dairy. Animal waste. Hey, if you eat meat, you create about 1 ton of animal waste for every meat-eating person in the United States. And it's a major polluter of water, soil, and air. So, in the United States, what do we eat? Well, 60% of our protein comes from animal sources. In the world, it's only 30%. So they use many more vegetarian meals. Way back.
Dr. Kuhn?
Yes. Yep.
As you're talking about food, we have one of our attendees who sent me an email because he may not be able to get on to ask questions. I have two from him. Do you want me to wait, or do you want me to ask them for him now because they pertain to food, which you're talking about?
Go ahead. Ask him now.
First question he had is, what are the most important foods to buy organic in the grocery store?
Okay, we have a list called the Dirty Dozen. You can find it online. The Dirty Dozen, if you can afford to buy only a small percent of organic, you want to buy the Dirty Dozen. Those are things like berries, like strawberries. How do you get the pesticides out of the seeds of the berry? Celery. Things with the skins, okay, that you consume. Don't bother buying bananas and oranges that are organic because you're going to peel them, okay? So look for the Dirty Dozen and eat organic for those.
Perfect. His second question is, what are the healthier options in restaurants? Yeah, that's a tough one.
Yeah, it is. Well, you'd like to go to restaurants that are interested in serving wild fish and organic grass-fed beef. Find those restaurants. I don't have any in my area. Probably salads would be a good option, but be careful of the salad dressing. Salad dressings are full of MSG and carcinogens. So, you know, it's really tough to eat in a restaurant. And fast food is impossible. I wish I had alternatives, but I really don't.
I would wonder if you know whether, I mean, if you go to certain places, like when I was down in Charleston recently, where I'm going again this week, and they have, like, you know, whole food restaurants that sort of really talk about trying to serve healthy choices, organic foods. Do those restaurants?
Yes. If you have a whole food or a Trader Vic's or Trader Joe's in your area, those are the places you want to shop, you want to buy food. Okay, they are certainly safer than any place else. Your grocery store is really, unfortunately, a bad place to buy food. Because it's a lot of toxins. Okay? And we can do another talk on food if you want to someday. So, anyhow, let's get back. The Surgeon General, way back in 2003, suggested we do one meatless meal or one meatless Monday. Way back in 2003, have we followed him? No. But his reason back then was to decrease saturated fat. But certainly we know today that it would be much better on our environment overall. Buy local whenever you can. Know where your food comes from. Now, we talked about inflammatory beef, but dairy, alcohol, sugary, high sugary foods are also inflammatory. So all of those are going to be decreasing the health of our body. When you shop, stay out of the middle of your grocery store. Shop the perimeter. That's where the healthier stuff is. And remember, the food industry is not a social service organization. They're in it to make money. And they keep on coming out with products like, how about vitamin waters? Oh, yeah, what's in it? High fructose corn syrup. So those things aren't healthy. They're just a way of getting more money out of your pocket. All right? Junk food. You can buy junk food in a health food store. Yeah, Whole Foods and Trader Joe's have good food, but there's also junk food in there. Potato chips are junk food. Doesn't make a difference where you buy them or what they're made out of. If you are reactive to a food, it is also inflammatory. So how about anti-inflammatory foods that you can buy, that you can eat? Wild fish, fish oils, flax seeds or chia seeds, onion and garlic. Try to do those at all three meals if you can. And then, of course, brightly colored fruits and vegetables. Fresh spices. Cut off the plant. In the winter, bring your plants inside if they're not going to survive all winter. Bring them inside and cut that rosemary or that oregano off the plant all winter. So grow them inside. Phytochemicals. Phytochemicals. Phytochemicals are in our plants. They give color and flavor to the plant, and these are what we think protect the plant. Well, when they get in us, they protect us as well. So phytochemicals that can protect us from some environmental toxins. How about carotenoids? They're found in orange fruits or orange vegetables, like squashes. This is a great time of year to eat your yellow squashes, and you can see what they do. Anthocyanidines are found in red and blue fruit. They protect the GI system. They try to keep it from leaking. They try to block some of that bad estrogen activity from your xenoestrogens that you're taking in. Polyphenols, tea, coffee, cocoa. We know that coffee today is a marvelous drink. Drink 4 or 5 cups of it a day as a caffeinated product if you want to. It protects our arteries. It's a superb antioxidant. And don't forget your green tea. Green tea drinkers, more than 4 or 5 cups a day, have less cancer, and if they get it, they develop it at a later age, and it's less progressive. So drink your green tea. And some other time, I'll tell you how to make green tea. It's not with a tea bag. Curcumin gives the red or the bright color to fruits and vegetables, like the skin of an apple or the blueberry, the blue on the blueberry. Absolutely reduces cancer proliferation. Raspberries have algaic acid. Can decrease inflammation of the body that's being caused by all these xenoestrogens and products that we put on our body. Indoles, cruciferous vegetables, oh, these are the absolute best. They protect against all kinds of cancer. When you eat a meat meal that has obviously some toxins in it because of how the cow was fed, assuming you're not eating organic, eat a big helping of broccoli with it. Because what the broccoli does is to soak up some of those carcinogens, and they exit with the broccoli as opposed to allowing them to be absorbed into your body and into your fat. Ideally, we should be eating about 2 pounds of broccoli a week. Oh, and there's always an from the class. Well, I'll give you an alternative here. If you hate broccoli, go for broccoli sprouts. Broccoli sprouts, 2 ounces of broccoli sprouts is the same value as eating 2 pounds of broccoli. Make sure when you buy them, they're pure broccoli sprouts. They're in an oblong box, usually in your grocery store. Don't buy mixed sprouts. Don't buy alfalfa. Buy pure broccoli sprouts. Better yet, do 2 pounds of broccoli and 2 ounces of broccoli sprouts a week. Antioxidant foods, the brightly colored fruits and vegetables. And remember that the antioxidant value is found on the surface of the fruit or the vegetable. So you're better off if you're eating blueberries. Eat a cup of small blueberries because you get more surface area in the cup of small berries than you do in a cup of large berries. Okay? Oranges. Where's the antioxidant value found in an orange? It's found on the pith, the white stuff that when you peel an orange, you peel off because it's a little bitter. Keep some of that on. That's the antioxidant value. All right, so what should you eat to try to get rid of some of these environmental toxins that are in our body? A rainbow of colors every day. This is not the rainbow I'm talking about. This is the rainbow. And that will then give you a huge amount of protection from phytochemicals. That will be your rainbow. And don't forget, vegetarian meals at least once, twice, three times a week, if not more. All
Dr.
right.
Dr. Kuhn, quickly, yes. When you're dealing with those dirty dozen foods and you're having a hard time finding them, say locally where I live, I don't have a lot of stores because I'm in the rural area, what is your thought about the product called FIT, F-I-T, which is supposed to be a fruit and vegetable wash?
No.
No, don't
you? You want to basically wash your fruits and vegetables with just running water. All of those products that you spray on fruits and vegetables, they've all got some chemicals in them. So you don't want to do that. You don't want to add, you know, something worse to something already bad. So just wash them under running water.
Okay, thank you.
Any other questions? Because I think we're at the end.
Folks, anybody have a question? We've got a few minutes left.
Hang on, let me. There's a couple of people that are still blocked.
Okay. There's a couple of people that are still
blocked. Kathleen is
okay.
Blocked, and Suzanne.
Oh, I'm sorry, I'm making noise.
No, that's all right.
All I can say is, yikes. It's kind of overwhelming. Thank you so much. I took this opportunity to, when you started talking about the cosmetics, to actually text my son's 20-year-old girlfriend, who probably does use cosmetics, and told her about safecosmetics.com, and she already texted me back and said she'll look into it. So, thank you.
Okay, just remember it's safecosmetics.org.
.org, right.
Yeah, that's what I did. Yeah, okay. Thanks for that and everything. And it's very impressive, the breadth and depth of what you're presenting. And wow.
Well, it's our environment. I mean, everybody's got to get on the bandwagon because it's amazing what's out there, and everybody's trying to kill us.
Yep.
Yeah, I'm sending out the
I'd like to know what you're agreeing to.
I'm sending out that on the listserv, you'll see the Safe Cosmetics connection. Go ahead.
Dr. Kuhn, this is John Hummer, and I just love your presentations. I'm so glad you're doing this. I was thinking maybe, you know, if you could come do one on foods, you know, the anti-cancer foods and other things, but what you presented about vitamins, the studies, the Canadian studies about, you know, which vitamins are garbage and which ones are actually rated very highly. I think that would be...
Well, we can certainly do that. That's a lecture almost unto itself. So, I mean, we can talk, and I'm certainly more than willing to do these.
That's fantastic.
Well, we do have you coming back in March. For those that are here today, we have Dr. Kuhn coming back, and I think it's March 12th or somewhere in mid-March, and she'll be talking specifically about the gut-brain connection, which we've spent a lot of time here talking about, Dr. Kuhn, and we see some of that stuff in our brain maps when we're doing, you know, QEG brain mapping. We can see some of those things, and we can tell you a bit more about that. So we'll look at maybe getting another date to do the safe foods piece.
Okay. Any other questions? I heard something about making green tea.
Yes, I was saying if there's an extra minute in it, if it's quick, you can give us
okay.
that. I'd love to hear it.
Making green tea. Don't use a tea bag. Buy loose green tea leaves. There's all kinds of stores that sell them. There's probably 200 or 300 different varieties of green tea leaves. The one I like the best is called gunpowder. So we're going to do to, and don't carry it, by the way, on plane. They don't like it when they see something listed as gunpowder. Okay, I tried that. all right, so what you're going to do your green tea, put a pot of water on the stove. I'm going to give you the recipe for a gallon. Put a pot of water on the stove, you know, a cup or so, not a whole lot, and just bring it to where the bubbles are just starting to surface. That's about 180 degrees, 160 to 180 degrees. Throw your green tea in that, and what I use is maybe 2 or 3 big pitches of dried green tea leaves. Now, I've drank green tea for years. I don't like the flavor. So I also put, and again, my recipe is for a gallon, I also put 4 herbal tea aspects, any variety you want, whether strawberry or peach or whatever, make sure they're herbal, make sure they're organic tea bags, and let it steep there for a while. Let it cool, and then you're going to add it to a gallon jug, make sure it's glass, and then fill it up with your filtered water, and you're all set. Enjoy.
And you were saying, Dr. Kuhn, that polyphenols get killed if you use boiling water. Is that correct?
Yes, they do. That's why you want to use it at 160 to 180 degrees. And by the way, if you want to do your green tea in a Mrs. Tea, that's fine. Don't brew it in a Mr. Coffee. Mr. Coffee brews coffee at about 210 degrees, so it kills the polyphenols.
All right, good to know. Good.
And for those that have some of the Keurig machines, some of the better Keurig machines do allow you to set the brewing temperature, so you could take it down to that range that she's talking about if you're going to brew tea in it.
Oh, okay.
Yep, there's one that I just got, and it's got a filter for the water and built in, and it has settings where you can have it go on and off, but it has the actual brewing temperature set. You can adjust it.
Interesting. Well, I must have the old cheap variety because I can't adjust that.
Yeah, my first one didn't either.
Dr. Kuhn.
Yes.
Dr. Kuhn,
can I ask one more very quick question?
I believe I'm first. Mine is very, very short. Dr. Kuhn, can we reach you? How can we reach you? I would like to communicate about electromagnetic environment.
You can reach me through my email. It should be on the handout.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
Okay, one more. Kathleen. Great.
Yeah, and you can just bottom line this. I get it. Paleo diet and Weston Price.
Whatever floats your boat. There
I know the inflammatory issue.
Well, there's no perfect diet. Your body, everybody's body is different. Some bodies do real well on the paleo diet. Some do well on the Atkins diet. Some do well on a vegetarian diet. You've got to figure out what works for your body and then use the healthiest foods you can that's on that diet. Think about the GAPS diet, too, is very appropriate for some people with gut issues. So nothing is perfect for everybody.
All right. Well, thank you so much. We look
Let me just finish up here. I've just got a couple of humor slides, I think. So hopefully you've enjoyed your lunch, okay? And let's go to church. Let's see if we can laugh a little bit. I found this on a church marquee in Mississippi. 9 o'clock theme, Jesus Walks on Water. 5 o'clock theme, Searching for Jesus. Huh. All right, how about ladies' Bible study? Be held on Thursday morning. All ladies are invited to the lunch in the fellowship hall after the BS is done. Maybe not a good initial for Bible study. And the bean supper will be held on Tuesday evening in the church hall. Music will follow. And Thursday, there's going to be a meeting of the Little Mothers Club. All wishing to become little mothers, please see the minister in his study. Don't think he really meant to say that. All right. And next week's sermon, what is hell? Come early and hear the choir practice. Boy, they wouldn't like that at all. All right, so have a ball for the rest of your day. The end for the ladies, the end for the men, and thank you very much for attending.
Thank you very much.
You are very welcome.
And we will be in touch.
Okay, sounds great.
And thanks, everybody. Thanks, Richard. I'm going to go. I've got a patient outside, so I'll see you all next week.
I do, too.
The handout was sent out. If you cannot undownload the handout, go ahead and email me, folks. But I'm gone for the weekend. It might be...